there we go.
I feel like I've given a sort of similar talk to a lot of you people before, so hopefully this won't be too boring. So so today I'm going to be talking about lifting Nullstellensatz to monotone span programs over any field. So let me first start by just telling you what a span program is. So this was mentioned in Avi's talk yesterday about how these were invented using the fusion method. So what is a span program? Well, a span program is just a matrix over a field. Okay. So here's any matrix. Here's like a matrix over every field. Okay. So a span program is not just a matrix though. So attached to the rows of the matrix, we're going to attach Boolean literals, so positive and negative. And then a span program is going to be a computational device for computing some Boolean function. So how does it do that? Well, if I give you a truth assignment to the literals on the rows, we sort of pick out the rows which are consistent with the Boolean assignment, and then we check if they span the all ones vector. So in this example, everything is true. So these rows would be consistent with the input. So just by summing them up, you can see that we're spanning the input vector, so we would accept. So for a second example, you know, if we had true, false, false, now this row is left out. And you know, observe that, you know, I'm going to let you sort of add literals on multiple rows. Like we can sort of reuse literals as many times as we want. And just for the sake of one rejecting input, you know, if we have false, 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 so this is the only vector that's consistent with my input. And it obviously doesn't span the all ones vector, so we wouldn't accept. Okay? This is a pretty elegant sort of program, but it's a little strange to think about what. So it's natural to wonder how they relate to other circuit models that exist in the literature. So it was introduced by Karshmar and Vanderson in 93. And non-monotone span programs over, say, GFP turn out to correspond to mod PL, or in the case of GF2, just parity L. Right? So that's just counting, you know, checking whether or not a branching program has like an odd number of accepting paths. But monotone span programs are actually like a very interesting model. And the reason is that they use non-monotone operations to compute monotone Boolean functions, right? And because of this, it makes them sort of difficult to deal with, like sort of intractable to deal with when you're trying to prove lower bounds for them. So, and another reason that monotone programs are actually interesting is that they sort of have tight relations to cryptography in the form of linear secret sharing schemes. So it turns out that the size of a monotone span program computing some Boolean function is exactly the same as the amount of information that needs to be shared in a cryptographic object called a linear secret sharing scheme. So proving lower bounds for these things and understanding the complexity of them is actually like sort of a very natural task. So here's sort of a picture. So this is kind of like an idea of how like sort of the standard circuit models sort of relate to span programs. And here are these inclusions. I'm just talking about monotone models, right? So in the non-monotone setting, we actually know that so span programs can simulate directed switching networks, and also they're simulated by circuits. But in the monotone setting, this is basically the best set of inclusions that we have. So most of these inclusions are fairly trivial. If you're not familiar with like a switching network or a directed switching network, just think like a branching program. It's just a measure of space, right? What's sort of known for like lower bounds for these things? Well, lower bounds for them actually seem to be quite hard. So a long sequence of works in the 90s sort of ultimately led to proving n to the omega log n lower bounds just for some monotone function computable in NP. Okay? Yeah.
What's the size of a...
Oh, it's the number of rows. I mean, like we can always assume it's the number of rows just by like a, you know, regular getting rid of the columns that are linearly dependent. Yeah. So works in the 90s like led to sort of n to the log n lower bounds, but just for sort of some strange monotone function in NP that was sort of like an artifact of the method. Later, Beeml and Weinreb were able to sort of take these techniques and use them to give, actually this shouldn't be log n, this should be root log n, separations between span programs over different fields. And all of these arguments were sort of very direct and ultimately sort of very combinatorial. Like they dealt with sort of looking at a span program, coming up with a combinatorial object that sort of obstructed the existence of a small span program, and then more or less directly constructing that. A few years ago, myself with Tony, Ben, and Steve, we proved the first exponential lower bounds, but only for span programs over the reals. Okay. And this was sort of an important part of our technique that the things we could only work over the real field. And our lower bounds even worked for some function in monotone P, which separated real monotone span programs from, say, monotone circuits. And we were also able to sort of improve them to get actually strongly exponential lower bounds, by which I mean like properly 2 to the n, right? And these lower bounds use ideas from like sort of lifting theorems, which is sort of this, you know, I'm sure everybody in this room is sort of familiar with it. It's sort of this new, well, old, but now like a paradigm in a communication complexity lower bounds. It's just been sort of very, very profitable in the last few years. But yeah, so the main emphasis here is that it still only works for real span programs. And it was kind of really annoying because this was really just an artifact of our technique. And it wasn't really clear how to fix them. So we were able sort of recently to actually sort of extend this result to get lower bounds for span programs over all fields. And in fact, we were able to sort of sharpen the result in a very nice way. So now we can sort of characterize the monotone span program size over an arbitrary field for certain structured functions. So here's the main theorem that I'm going to talk about today. So it basically says the following. So if I give you if you give me an unsatisfiable CNF, so it's just some unsatisfiable CNF formula, then there's some monotone function which you can construct from this CNF, such that the monotone span program size of the function over that field is sort of tightly characterized up to the exponent by the Nullstellensatz degree of refuting this formula. Okay. So the Nullstellensatz degree of refuting the thing. So Nullstellensatz is just a proof system in propositional proof complexity for algebra for Christian. I guess it's a nice theorem in algebraic geometry. So the nice thing about this is that it's obviously quite pleasant. It sort of characterizes exactly what we can do, at least for these particular structured functions. And in particular, it allows us to sort of appeal to like the huge literature on Nullstellensatz lower bounds to actually obtain good span program lower bounds.
Robert, it's a minor point, but is it like n choose the Nullstellensatz degree, or what happens when the degree is n?
Right, good. So when the degree is n, we can actually sharpen this even further. If the degree is like theta n, you can actually make this a constant.
Yeah, that's
so it, so it is basically n choose the Nullstellensatz degree. Yeah. Yeah. Any other questions before I keep going? Okay. So for the people who are familiar with lifting theorems, this should look a lot like a lifting theorem, and that's because ultimately it is. you know, what we're doing is we're lifting sort of the sort of strange part from the normal lifting theorems is that the normal lifting theorems are sort of stated in a pure communication complexity language. And here I've sort of eliminated that, and I'm just talking about proofs going directly to circuits. Right? But ultimately, the mechanics at the end of the day is all, the intuition just comes exactly from lifting theorems. So what can we actually get from known Nullstellensatz lower bounds? Well, if you start with something like the induction principle, which is a really fancy way of just saying like the principle, like the following unsatisfiable formula, where you say x1 is true, and then, you know, x1 implies x2, x2 implies x3, and so on until you get xn is actually false, right? So this thing is trivially unsatisfiable. It turns out that the Nullstellensatz degree, which I haven't told you what Nullstellensatz exactly is yet, but we'll see it a bit later. So it turns out that the Nullstellensatz degree of induction is tightly theta log n. And it turns out that when you do this transformation from an unsatisfiable formula to a function, you just get ST connectivity on the other side. And so this tells us immediately that the monotone span program of ST connectivity is n to the log n over. So this separates, this actually provides a separation on the previous slide. So over in the non-monotone case, span programs can of course compute can do ST connectivity. So this actually separates, this is a non-monotone-monotone separation as well. If you take like the Pebbling formulas, then the function you get is gen, if you don't know what gen is, you can literally think of it as just monotone circuit evaluation. Like I give you a monotone circuit and you plug in some inputs and then just evaluate what the output is. It turns out that the Nullstellensatz degree of the Pebbling principle is tightly characterized by a combinatorial measure of the graph, the reversible Pebbling number. And so this tells us that there's graphs with sort of very high Pebbling number. So this gives exponential lower bounds by just plugging in any one of those graphs. And finally, if you start with sort of like a modular counting principle, which you can just think of as like a CNF encoding of like a system of unsatisfiable equations, mod p. So you run it through the machine, and then what you're going to get is some function. It's going to be guaranteed to be computed in NP. At the time that we wrote the paper, like if you go back and look at it, we didn't really have a, I mean, like I can tell you what the function is, but we didn't really have a really nice characterization of the function. So now I can, now actually with an upcoming work, we can tell you what the nice function is. It's actually it's a monotone version of mod psat. So what do I mean by that? Well, it's just, so imagine the following. Take all of the, so imagine you have like a fixed set of Boolean variables, okay? And then what you're gonna do is you're gonna, the input to this problem is gonna be a subset of, say, mod p constraints on these variables, right? So the more constraints that I add, the more unsatisfiable it's going to become, right? So then the question is, if I give you a collection of constraints on these variables, just decide if it's unsatisfiable or not, right? So this is clearly a monotone function. It turns out that running it through this machine, this is exactly the function that we're going to get on the other side. And sort of classic results, let us separate the Nullstellensatz degree of over different fields using this. So if the characteristic of the field is p, then the counting principles have constant Nullstellensatz degree. And if the characteristic is not equal to p, then it turns out it's actually linear. So yeah, so this gives sort of exponential separations between span programs over all fields. Yeah?
So if you pick p equals 2, isn't that just Gaussian elimination?
Yes. Well,
you get a function in p?
Not in monotone p, though. You do get a function in p, that's right. Yeah. So, yeah.
You get a monotone function in p.
Yeah, that's right.
It's really monotone.
Yeah, so this would, yeah, that's right. You get a monotone function that's definitely in p, but it's not, it turns out it's not in monotone p.
But no, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, is there any questions? Any other questions about the sort of the results? Okay. So yeah, let me just take a second here. So this result here, so sort of this new understanding of what this function is, this is coming in an upcoming work between me and Mika and Dimitri and Pratish. So I think Mika's gonna talk about it a little bit later today, so be sure to go and see it. There's some cool stuff there. But yeah, okay. So just in summary, so you know, we can now kind of nicely characterize span program size. In certain regimes, we can sharpen parameters. And we also get some other results, which I'll talk about now. So how does the proof work? Well, the main idea is just what I said a second ago. Really, the intuition is coming at the end of the day from communication complexity. So let me just remind you about the Karshmer-Vigerson game, which we've all seen probably many times, like this workshop even. So if you start with any monotone Boolean function, we can associate with it the following communication problem, right? So Alice gets a 1 of the function, Bob gets a 0 of the function, and they want to find an input such that Alice has a 1 there and Bob has a 0 there. So this is definitely going to occur if the function is monotone. So what does it look like? Well, the best picture that I can give you is something like this. So all of the certificates for this monotone Boolean function form a combinatorial rectangle in like the cross product of the ones and the zeros of the function, right? So, and you know, a common theme in complexity theory, of course, is that the complexity of this search problem in different communication models tends to characterize the circuit complexity of F, specifically the monotone circuit complexity of F in the case of the monotone Karshmer-Vigerson game, right? So a nice fact, which I'd actually like to sort of advertise, that it's sort of a classic result, but I think that everybody should know it, is that monotone Karshmer-Vigerson games actually like characterize search problems in communication complexity. So what do I mean by that? Well, if you start with sort of any covering by rectangles, so let's just say this is like the cross product of two arbitrary sets, right? You can imagine this is a communication problem where if I have some, you know, covering by rectangles, Alice gets an input here and Bob gets an input here, and they just want to output what rectangle they lie in, right? This sort of characterizes a you know, communication search problems with that have low non-deterministic protocols, right? Well, we can easily transform this into a monotone Karshmer-Vigerson game for some monotone function, some partial monotone function. So how do we do that? Well, if I pick a row here, all I'm going to do is I'm just going to write down the rectangles that this input lies in, right? So x here occurs in x1, x2, and x3. So he just writes down the, Alice will just write down the bit string corresponding to that. And on the other hand, Bob will put down a 1 for the rectangles he doesn't belong in, right? So Bob here lies in x3 and x4, so he'll put 2 zeros there, and then he'll put a 1 for the rectangles he doesn't align in, right? So now you can just see that the place where they intersect, right? Well, that's exactly a solution to the monotone Karshmer-Vigerson game for these two inputs. So in this sense, monotone Karshmer-Vigerson games are sort of complete for search problems in communication complexity. And in some sense, the study this what this is telling us is that the study of search problems in communication complexity is literally monotone circuit complexity, right? It's like these are just the same things, sort of. Does that make sense? Yeah. Okay. Cool. So how does this help us? Well, here's the theorem we want to prove. Well, like, what I haven't really told you how to do is, how am I going to go from this unsatisfiable formula here to some Boolean function? And the trick is to just utilize this connection that I just sort of showed you, right? So if I start with some unsatisfiable CNF formula, there's a natural search problem associated with it. That's not really a communication problem, because, you know, it, like, basically it's just I give you a you know, some input to the formula, and then just ask you to tell me a clause that's falsified by the formula, right? But using the intuition from these lifting theorems, if I just imagine replacing each of these variables with some good function g, which has a bipartite input domain, right? Then you can naturally construct a communication problem, which is just Alice gets all like values for all the x variables. Bob gets all the values for the y variables. They want to evaluate, g of x on every single coordinate, and then just plug it into the search problem and find the clause. Does that make sense? Hopefully there's nothing complicated going on here. I'm just doing a composition, just plugging in a g for every variable to sort of force this search problem to be a communication problem. So this is definitely a search problem, right? So by what I just showed you, every search problem in communication complexity corresponds to some monotone Boolean function. So all we have to argue is that, we want to get some control over how many inputs the function has, right? And of course, with monotone Karshmer-Vigdorsen games, the number of rectangles, if we go back here, the number of rectangles is just the number of input variables. So what we really need to control is how good of a non-deterministic protocol, or how many rectangles there are in a rectangle covering of this search problem. And it's not hard to convince yourself, actually, that as long as this unsatisfiable formula has bounded width, then the search problem can't have too many rectangles. Okay. So that might actually bear like a little bit more spelling out. So let me just say it a little bit more precisely. So if we imagine this as sort of being our communication matrix, after I do the composition, so Alice gets some string in x to the n, and Bob gets some string in y to the n, right? So you can ask, okay, well, what are the objects that correspond to all the outputs of this search problem, right? It's not obvious that they're going to be rectangles necessarily, right? Like, it's not necessarily the case that if I ask, what are all the inputs that Alice and Bob get that correspond, that falsify, C1? That's not necessarily going to be a rectangle, right? Because it totally depends on the definition of G, right? So you might get some sort of wacky object instead, which corresponds to X1. And for X2, you might get some sort of wacky object, right? So in this reduction I just showed you a second ago, it was really important that this was actually a rectangle covering, like a good non-deterministic protocol. But if C is bounded width, what we can basically do is just sort of break this up into rectangles in sort of a trivial way. Like, all you have to do is just observe that if C is width k, then that means that there's at most k variables for either of the players in any of the certificates. So that means that I can just brute force over one of the player's inputs, right? And just say, okay, well, for every value to one of the player's inputs, that's going to give me one sort of sub-rectangle in here. So normally, if these were actually just rectangles, we would just get C, but we actually managed to get like a C with a polynomial factor.
So here, it's important that G involve only a constant number of variables?
No, this can work with an arbitrary number of variables. Yeah. So even with polynomially many in N, it's okay.
No, so what? But X is not X to the N. X is with just one. X is just one alphabet symbol.
Yeah, that's right. So ultimately, like, what we're going to end up doing is translating Nullstellensatz lower bounds to span program lower bounds, right? So we really have to pay attention to what the inputs are in both cases. So for Nullstellensatz, the complexity measure that we care, like the number of inputs really is how many clauses there are, right? Like in proof complexity, we want to measure the complexity in terms of how big the formula is. So this is exactly related to the number of input variables of the final function that I get.
Right.
Up to a polynomial factor in the number of variables underlying it.
Okay. But so isn't there like an x to the k in your description?
Oh, yeah, sorry. I think I might have written into, this should probably be x to the k there. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, actually, you're right. That's a typo there. That should be x to the k. Thank you. Yeah. Because we'll brute force over one of the player's inputs, so that'll be x to the k. Yeah. But even if x is like polynomial in m, we're still happy. Yeah. Yeah. Does that make sense? Okay, so this is sort of the way that, this is how we're going to get this actual monotone function. So there's an even nicer characterization of what you can do here. I'll leave that for later. So how do we?
Yep. The k confused me. I thought the physics enter the k. I'm sorry for the.
No, yeah, this should not be here. This should be, it should actually be n is like basically size of x to the k, size of c.
The number of variables in z does not matter?
No. I mean, like, this will be the number of ultimately the Nullstellensatz lower bounds, like, will depend on both of these things. Like, the Nullstellensatz lower bounds, we want them to be a function of m, but usually m is like a function of n itself. So it does ultimately have a dependence on n, but sort of that's not a parameter that we really care about.
M by n to the k.
Yeah.
For example.
Yeah, right. Is that okay?
No, but
Okay. So why is this good? Well, okay. So there's one other complexity measure that we're going to use to really get the lower bound part of this characterization. And this is this nice measure due to Robere from the 90s that we've been calling the rank measure. So the idea of the rank measure is pretty simple. So if you start with a monotone Boolean function, and you have, you know, your sort of Karshmer-Vigerson matrix, like your matrix with your rectangles describing how the function is working. So we can define the rank measure as follows. It's the following complexity measure. It's just take any matrix A that you'd like and sort of imagine just make like overlaying it on the Karshmer-Vigerson game. And then all you're measuring is what the rank of A is versus the rank of A restricted to any one of the subrectangles.
So A is contained in F inverse 1?
A is a F inverse 1 by F inverse 0 matrix. Yep. So in this picture, if we had an actual sort of rectangle covering here, that was x1, x2. x3, and I don't know, x4. So I can just imagine putting in a field entry in every single guy here, right? And then all I'm measuring is the rank of the total matrix divided by the rank of any one of these submatrices. Okay. So it turns out that this measure is like a lower bound on nearly all of the complexity measures that we care about here. So it's a lower bound on formula size, on switching network size. If the field is the same, it's a lower bound on Fs, on span programs over that same field. And it's also a lower bound on comparator circuits, which are sort of which just think of like sorting networks, basically, just like converted to a Boolean circuit model. Okay. So, I mean, why should this even be true? I mean, let me just point out that it's sort of very easy to see this for formula size, say. So, if I have a tiling, like a formula in the communication world, it's going to give me a tiling of the underlying matrix. Right, a monochromatic tiling. So that's going to give me a partition. That tiling gave me a partition of A. Right. So ultimately, what it's going to boil down to is the subadditivity of rank. Right. If I just take rank on both sides and then just rank is subadditive, then I can just take the maximum rank and just drag it out. Right.
That's so that's going to give you the number of rectangles.
That's going to give me the number of rectangles in my tiling. Yeah. So. This is sort of, for our purposes, like the real complexity measure that we're going to focus on for lower bounds. So I can now sort of give you an outline. So I don't believe that any sort of individual step in this proof is very difficult, but I think that there are a lot of steps, and it's complicated to remember how everything wires together. So let me just sort of give you a sort of a broad outline. So the first step that we're going to start of is that we need this way of translating Nullstellensatz bounds into rank bounds, right? And ultimately what this boils down to is coming up with a way to translate polynomial degree into matrix rank, right? So this is sort of the central lemma that makes this entire thing click. It's sort of like a clean way to lift polynomial degree to matrix rank over every field. So using this, we can get the upper bound sort of almost immediately from the definition of a span program in Nullstellensatz. We can then do a lower bound separately using this rank measure. But I'm not going to get the lower bound directly in terms of Nullstellensatz right away. I'm going to get the lower bound in terms of a different complexity measure, which I'm going to call like just the algebraic gap, which I'll explain that in a bit. Okay. So then finally, the last step is just a duality theorem that's showing that this algebraic gap and the Nullstellensatz thing, they're actually the same thing all along. So this is a new theorem from this work. So the prior lower bounds that we had for real span programs, we had basically this theorem over the reals and for the algebraic gap. But we didn't have a way to lift polynomial degree over arbitrary fields. Right? So this is sort of the main new thing that makes this whole thing tick. And then the characterization of the gap by Nullstellensatz degree is another thing that we figured out that sort of puts a nice clean answer to everything. So let me talk about this sort of main lemma here. So what are we going to do? Well, it's pretty simple. So if we start with any polynomial, which is going to be, we'll always assume things are multilinear. We're in a multilinear world here, okay? And then for any good gadget, okay, which I'll tell you what good means in a second, you can compose the gadget with the polynomial, just like we did before with the unsatisfiable formula. And what you get at the end of the day is a matrix, right? I've written P composed with G to the N to just mean the X to the N to the Y to the N matrix, where you just, you know, at the point, you just evaluate the gadget and plug the values into the polynomial. Does that make sense? So it turns out that for well-behaved gadgets, you can characterize what the rank of this matrix is going to be in terms of the degree of the underlying polynomial. So the rank of the matrix is just going to be the sum over all the monomials occurring in the polynomial of, well, we have some term raised to the size of the monomial here, right? And this term right here is just that we can just imagine this as like an X by Y matrix over this field, right? So it turns out that the correct value is actually like the rank of this underlying gadget here. So you can see here that like the monomials, the set of monomials that occur in the polynomial characterize the rank of this matrix. Like we can just sort of look at the spectrum of the thing and it just sort of tell you immediately what the rank of the matrix is going to be. So an earlier result of Shurstov from this pattern matrix method paper gives, it turns out, like a corollary of this result. So he shows for when over the reals and for a particular gadget, he gets exactly this expression, but this rank is not the rank, it's just some parameter associated with the gadget. And it turns out that if you just dig into his proof, it's actually the parameter is just the rank of the gadget if you treat it as a matrix. And now, this was actually part of the difficulty with trying to generalize this thing was that Shurstov's proof only worked for the reals, and this, like, he actually went and used analysis, right? And of course, like a singular value decompositions and things like this. And obviously that's not going to work over a finite field. So this was sort of the main thing preventing us from actually getting things to work over an arbitrary field. So I'm going to show you sort of a very simple algebraic proof which will work over every field. Okay? So what's the idea? Well, the idea is to first just like look at the structure of this matrix. So what does it look like? Let's take the simplest case and let's imagine that this polynomial is just like a single monomial. Okay? So maybe it's like, maybe I have three variables, z1, z2, and z3, and the monomial is just z1 times z3. Okay? So the matrix is going to look something like this, right? I'll range over all inputs, and I'll just multiply together, you know, the substitution in by g. Okay? Well, I'm going to, just for the purpose of making the expression nicer, I can sort of space this out and imagine that I'm also plugging in x2 and y2, right? So that's just like the indicator one function. Well, I mean, this is just a tensor product, right? This is just G tensored with one tensored with G, okay? So this is actually like quite nice for us, right? Because matrix rank is, we know, is multiplicative for tensoring, but of course it's not additive, right? So if P was not a single monomial, but instead of like a sum of monomials, then I would get a sum of matrices of this form, like a sum of tensors, right? And if rank was additive, then I could just add them up, and then I'd be happy, because, you know, it's definitely multiplicative. But of course it's not, and then that tells us exactly how we should define G. We should define G to make rank additive, right? So, okay, well, what is a good gadget? Well, it's just good if for every pair of matrices with the same dimensions, if I tensor with 1 on one side and G on the other side, then it just makes rank additive on the other side. Does that make sense? And now, once we have this, it's just like it's just a super straightforward induction, right? So just take your polynomial and just factor out the first variable, and then just, you know, inductively, we know. After I do the composition, I know it's going to have this form, right? I can just take out the 1s and the g's, and then just inductively continue down. So there you go. Yeah. All right, so is that sort of clear to everybody?
What is a good gadget, like an example?
Oh, what's an example? Good. There's a simple one. Here's one. So just take a quality and remove one of the 1s off the diagonal. So it's a little bit weird. Also, Shurstov's gadget is good, because of course, by what I just said a second ago. So why is this good? Well, I mean, it's actually really easy to see this, right? Like, if 1 tensored with A plus G tensored with B, well, 1 tensored with A is just going to look like a matrix of A's. G tensored with B is going to look like, you know, B's on the diagonal. So then if I add these up, I get this matrix. But then, you know, this is obviously, like, the rank of this is obviously the rank of A plus the rank of B, right? After you do some row and column manipulations. Does that make sense? Cool. So this is actually interesting, because sort of an important point here is that in order for this to occur, this is just like sort of an aside, it's clear that I'm going to need G to be rank deficient. It can't be a full rank matrix, right? Because if G is a full rank matrix, then I can't get like an A here. Like I can't like extract out a factor of A here. So this lifting theorem, even though it works for, you know, clearly constant size gadgets, right? It somehow, like the gadgets have to be special. Like they have to be you know, rank deficient. Yeah.
Type your essay is a particular reason why you had 3 1s and 1 0?
Yeah. That's right. Sorry?
I was asking, is there a particular reason why you have that?
Oh no, it's just that's just what fits on the slide.
No, you wanted to get 3. I mean, it's not rank of A plus rank of B, it's rank of A plus 3 rank of B.
Is
the rank of G.
Yeah.
I think what he's saying is that this works with any number of 1s less than full rank.
Yeah, absolutely. If this was the identity matrix, then this equality wouldn't hold. That's what I was just saying. Thanks, Josh. Yeah, but this manipulation, this exact same manipulation works for any size matrix like this, right?
So even like 2x2?
Well, 2x2 it would work, but you don't get anything interesting because the rank of G is 1, right? You just get the rank of A plus the rank of B. So you would still get the lifting theorem, but you know, like in the... If I just scroll back for a second, in the statement of it, I would get, you know, the sum of 1s. So it would just be like the number of monomials in the polynomial. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, I guess it's interesting. It would be like the sparsity or something.
Because then it's the n function. So.
Yeah. Oh yeah, right. Well, actually, okay. Well, that's good then. This is a way of recovering that, because when you do and composition, the rank is the sparsity, right? So that's a corollary of this. Okay.
So Robert.
Yeah.
Do you have an understanding of what kind of matrices give you a good gadgets?
So I don't. I would love to have a nicer characterization of this. So what an easy thing to observe is that if we don't work over 0, 1, but we work over -1, 1, right, which is obviously fine. You know, I can still do multilinear expansions and things. Any matrix of like this form, or maybe I shouldn't use A. Like any matrix of like this form. C minus C would work, right? That's just sort of trivial. and this is, in fact, the structure of Shurstov's gadget. It's the index gadget with the negation of the index gadget below it. But I don't have a nice structural characterization. Like, for the purpose of lower bounds, we just wanted like a constant size gadget, and this works beautifully. So, yeah. Okay, all right. So let me talk about this lower bound theorem then. So how much time do I have left? 20 minutes. Okay. Okay. Well. So the main step here is we're going to sort of prove, like, actually prove the lifting theorem. And if you remember the expression for the rank measure, it's basically immediate from the thing I just showed you before. So all we need to show is that, you know, the rank measure is at least n to the gap. So I need to tell you what this gap is. Okay, what does that mean? Well, let me just show you by an example. So if I start with an unsatisfiable CNF, so here's like the stupidest unsatisfiable CNF I could think of, right? It's like saying that like everything has to be false and also something has to be true. Okay? So associated with every clause, there's like the certificate, you know, that falsifies that clause, just like the partial assignment falsifies only that clause. And now what the algebraic gap complexity is it's the minimum, so I take a multilinear polynomial over the same set of variables. So I've got z's here, I should have put x's, but that's fine. So it's a multilinear polynomial. So the polynomial is going to have degree n. And what I'm going to measure is how much the polynomial simplifies when I hit it with any one of these restrictions. So it's going to be the maximum gap between the degree of the polynomial, which is n, and the maximum degree of this polynomial after I hit it with any one of these restrictions. Okay. So this is the gap at this polynomial, and then we just call the gap complexity to be the maximum over at any polynomial. Right? So it looks a little bit strange at first, but if you remember what the rank measure looked like, this should look a lot like the log of the rank measure, right? If you think of, you know, the degree as being the rank and then like the submatrices corresponding to the restrictions. And that's exactly what we're going to end up doing. But I mean, can someone guess what a good polynomial would be to make the rank measure maximized here, or make the gap complexity maximized here?
Product of all the variables. Right?
Yeah, sure. Or. Yeah, exactly. Right. So, I mean, it's pretty clear that the degree of or is n. Right? But then if I hit it with any one of these restrictions, it's obviously going to simplify it to a constant. And so it's going to drop to zero. So the gap for this, so the algebraic gap of this formula we would say is n. Does that make sense? Okay, well, like I said a second ago, if you just sort of line these things up, like the gap complexity looks a lot like the log of the rank measure if you blur your eyes and forget what degree and rank are. so it turns out that you can actually make this sort of formal. And the idea is to just compose using the lifting theorem I just showed you a second ago. So start with a polynomial that has a good algebraic gap. Take your good gadget, right? Compose it. And what you're going to get is you're going to get a matrix with really high rank because the degree of the polynomial initially is large. And then you have to do some work to line things up. But what we want to do is line up the certificates in the algebraic gap with the subrectangles of this matrix. Right? So it's a little bit of work to do this, but I mean, you can do this. And then the nice thing is that then the rank of the rank of that submatrix, it's just going to be it's going to be defined by the degrees of the polynomials under this restriction. And I just said that the degree of the polynomial is going to, you know, simplify a lot under every restriction. So there you go. Okay. Is that sort of clear? I mean, this is a little bit hand-wavy, but maybe you at least sort of understand the idea. Yeah.
So the variables of your new problem are in correspondence with the clauses
that's
of
right.
the original CNF?
That's right. And it makes sense if you think about this SAT problem I told you before, right? The input, if you think about it as the input is specifying sets of clauses, that's what they're coming from the underlying CNF formula, right? Any other questions? So let me talk about the upper bound. The upper bound, fortunately, is a lot easier. But first I need to tell you what a Nullstellensatz refutation is. Yeah?
Did you just get this jointness in some abstract way? So it's O of N when composed?
I see. Yeah, possibly, yeah. So the original end of the log N lower bounds by Rasparov are actually proved by like a reduction to small set disjointness ultimately. And his reduction is actually very similar. It's not phrased in this language at all, but the reduction is basically the same. So probably you could phrase it in this way. Yeah. But because disjointness has large like co-NP complexity, it means you have to focus on like small set disjointness to make the number of variables not blow up. But yeah, maybe I can explain that a bit more offline. So let me tell you what a Nullstellensatz refutation is. Well, it's pretty simple. If I give you some set of polynomials p1 through pm, a Nullstellensatz refutation is just another set of polynomials such that the sum of the products is 1, right? And what this tells you is that these original polynomials right here, they don't have any common zero, right? Because if there was some input on which they had a common zero, that would simplify this to 0, but we would have 0 equals 1. Right? So the degree of a Nullstellensatz refutation is going to be the maximum degree of any one of these products. Okay. And we can think of Nullstellensatz as being like a propositional proof system for refuting unsatisfiable CNFs. Just by taking unsatisfiable CNFs and sort of encoding them as polynomials in some, you know, in sort of your favorite way. Okay? So here's like the standard way of doing it. Here's a really simple unsatisfiable CNF. So for every clause, I'm just going to turn it into a polynomial such that the clause will be satisfied if and only if the polynomial is 0. Right? So that way we can apply the Nullstellensatz sort of in the normal way. So yeah, here hopefully you can convince yourself that this is satisfied if and only if this is 0. So the idea is you just take your CNF, apply the conversion to every clause, and then also add in some xi squared minus xi polynomials to ensure that, you know, we're only considering 0-1 solutions. Right? And of course, if you can like multilinearize and kind of forget that these are here, but just for the sake of the talk, maybe like we can include them. Okay. So the Nullstellensatz refutation of a C then is just the minimum degree of a Nullstellensatz refutation over F. Okay. So in order to lift Nullstellensatz, so now we're trying to prove the upper bound, right? So in order to lift Nullstellensatz to span program size, what I'll do is I'm going to introduce a variant of span, like an alternative definition of span program size introduced by Anna, actually, Anna Gal, which is very, very, very nice. So here is a communication complexity sort of characterization of span program size. So here's our Karsmer-Vigerson matrix again. So let's just imagine blowing the matrix apart into like its constituent rectangles. Okay? So what I'm going to do is for each one of these rectangles, just pick any matrix like before, but such that the non-zero entries of the of the matrix are only going to occur inside the rectangles. Does that make sense? So I'll call such an object an algebraic tiling if the sums of all of these matrices is the all ones matrix. Okay? So it's kind of like a tiling. Like if I had a regular tiling, like an actual tiling of the matrix, then I could just plug in the all ones matrix at every single tile, right? And then I would get, you know, the sum is all one. It's just telling me that every entry is covered. So this is kind of like a generalization of this where I'm allowing the tiles to overlap, but I'm keeping the constraint that the sum algebraically has to be 1. So the size of the algebraic tiling is then going to be the sum of the sizes of the ranks of the individual matrices. Okay. So it turns out that the algebraic tiling number, so the size of the smallest algebraic tiling, is actually exactly the same as monotone span program size. And this is a very, very beautiful proof, and I'd like highly recommend you go look at it. It's very, very nice. So, but this, for our purposes, it gives us kind of a simple communication complexity measure to work with. And once again, like before with the gap compared to the rank measure, just looking at this, you should think it also kind of looks a lot like a Nullstellensatz refutation, right? So like, why is that? Well, I mean, if we have a Nullstellensatz refutation, and here I kind of, you know, abuse notation just plugging in ci instead of the polynomial itself. So an algebraic tiling, on the other hand, well, an algebraic tiling is just a sum of matrices, just that all the matrices is exactly 1, and each ai is embedded in some rectangle, right? Whereas over here we have the sum of the products is exactly 1. Now, I could even make these look even more the same, right? Just by placing an indicator for the rectangle being multiplied, say, Hadamard-wise, right here. So, you know, and since the complexity over here is the maximum degree of the Nullstellensatz refutations, and the complexity here is the sum of the ranks, it's natural to, you know, take the lemma I showed you a second ago and just plug it in here. And it turns out exactly that works. So all we're going to do then is we're just going to compose a Nullstellensatz refutation with a good gadget. So take each of these guys and just plug in your good gadget on either side. Automatically, we're going to get that it's going to be equal to 1. We know that, you know, we know that we can control the ranks of these things from the degrees of these polynomials over here because the gadget is good. And so all you have to argue is that, you know, what I'm actually getting over here is an algebraic tiling for like a real function. And that, again, is just sort of like some technical work to push stuff around, but it's not that bad. It just more or less goes by what I showed you maybe 20 minutes ago with the characterization of the lifted search problem. Does that make sense? Okay. So I got 10 minutes left. I thought I was gonna go long, so I actually I didn't even think I was gonna get here. So my I'll tell you what my original thing was, but now maybe I can actually tell you a bit more about it on the board. So my original think claim was to just go see the paper if you wanted to see the duality theorem. But maybe I can actually sort of sketch a little bit on the board with the 10 minutes I have left. Does that sound good? So obviously, once we have this equality, this makes everything tick, right? Like we can just sort of everything will sort of simplify, and we'll get sort of the characterization up to the constant and the exponent. So what's the intuition behind this? Well, let's recall what the gap and the Nullstellensatz look like. So the gap of f at C, say at a polynomial p. So p, of course, is degree n, and it's multilinear. So this is just going to be n minus the maximum over all the certificates of p, of c, sorry. The degree at the restriction.
Talking about general systems of polynomials, would it make sense to replace the degree of restriction with the degree of p mod qi mod pi?
Yeah, you can talk about that. I don't think it characterizes Nullstellensatz anymore.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I tried that. I just algebraically doesn't really work out.
Okay.
Yeah. Good question though. I tried for quite a while to try and see if you could do this for arbitrary polynomials, but it seems that the fact that things are multilinear is somehow very important here. Okay. So, now the Nullstellensatz degree of C, I'm just going to write like the sum of Ci times Qi, right? Like a Nullstellensatz is just, a Nullstellensatz reputation just looks like this. And then it's just going to be the maximum. Let's say I equals 1 to m. I in M of the degree of the product. Okay. All right. Well, so I claim that one of these directions is actually very easy, and it basically just follows from the upper bound argument that the span program size is lower bounded by the rank measure. Okay. So how does it work? Well, suppose I actually had one of these Nullstellensatz refutations right here. Okay? Sum ci qi equals 1. And then let's just pick a polynomial p for this gap. So if you multiply p on both sides, right? I'm just going to get something like this. Okay? I'm going to just multilinearize everything so I don't have to worry about the x squared minus x constraints because those are just a pain. All right? So let's just do this and let's just take the degree, okay, of each side. So what are we going to get? Well, all you get is that ci times pi qi equals, well, let's say the degree.
What is pi?
Should be p. Thanks. So I'm just going to fold that in and then just take the degree on both sides. So this on this side is definitely going to be n. Okay? And then over here, well, the degree of the sum is going to be the maximum degree of any one of the individual guys, right? Okay, so. Right? So, I mean, now we're done, right? Because all we have, because like, what's happening right here? Well, like.
This CI times P restricted by CI.
That's exactly right, yeah. This is just P restricted by that guy right there, right? So now, you know, oh, sorry, there should be a degree here. So now, you know, the degree of the product is the sum of the degrees. I can just drag this degree over here, and then I get what's left over here is just going to be the degree of this product right here. Okay. So that direction is actually very easy. Does that make sense? Okay. So the other direction follows just by this sort of alternative characterization of Nullstellensatz degree in terms of designs. And the reason, basically, if you're familiar with what a design is, the reason that this works is that the algebraic gap is just a design, but written in a in the polynomial basis instead of as a linear functional. Yeah. So what do I mean by that? Well, okay. So a design is sort of the classic way of proving Nullstellensatz lower bounds. So if I have suppose I have a Nullstellensatz refutation, and I want to argue that it has large degree. Like any Nullstellensatz refutation of this CNF has large degree. So the natural thing to do is to come up with sort of a linear functional, and all the linear functional is going to do is it's going to map, you know, all the low degree polynomials that are in the ideal generated by the CIs to zero, and it's going to map 1 to 1, right? So if L, this is a linear functional. So people who are familiar with SOS, this should look very familiar. So I'm just going to, so it's just going to enforce that, you know, 1 is mapped to 1. And I'll just say, because I only have like 5 minutes left, that L of, let's call it R, where R is sort of, like in the ideal generated here, like it's just like from multiplications of, low degree multiplications of CI, is 0. So R is from, say, low degree ideal generated by CIs. Pi. Does that make sense? So clearly, if such an object exists, then just applying it to any candidate low-degree Nullstellensatz refutation would show that it's not actually a Nullstellensatz refutation, right? So now what I claim is that if you a linear functional is just exactly the same as the thing P which witnesses your algebraic gap. So you have to squint and turn sideways a bit. So this is actually like an isomorphism, I guess. So why is that? Well, just take your linear functional, and instead of writing it over, you know, instead of imagining it as a functional, take it in like the dual basis. Just write it down as a polynomial. And then finally, invert everything. So map the high degree elements of your functional to the low degree elements. Just like flip it upside down. So this will convert this constraint, L of 1 equals 1, after taking the dual basis and flipping it, we'll just get that the degree of the corresponding functional is n. That's exactly the first constraint right here. So then the second constraint is this thing, which just says that all the polynomials have to cancel out. Well, if you actually go in and look at what a polynomial generated in this ideal is, when you write it in the dual basis, it's just exactly the certificate canceling property. Right? So saying that this is always going to be 0 after I do the flip, it's just the same as saying that the degree is going to be low after I hit it with all the restrictions. Yeah?
So by dual basis, you're replacing each product by the product of all the terms, the monomial by the product of all the terms. Because you're not over plus 1. But anyway, you want to...
Yeah.
You're dividing the monomial into the product of all the terms.
Yeah, like just imagine like writing down all the monomials like in a sum and just like decorating the coefficients with the values here. Except I'm gonna flip them.
What do you mean by flip them? That's what.
Yeah, right. So I'll replace. Where did I put my pen? There it is. So I'll replace some. So if I have a monomial, say product of xi for I and s, the coefficient here isn't going to be, like the natural thing to put there is going to be L of s, but in order to get this this thing to work, I'm going to put in L of n minus s. So that's what I mean by flip them, right? So now hopefully it should be clear. Like this L of 1 is 1 just means that this will have degree n. And then, you know, you just have to do some linear algebra to work out that actually this constraint just corresponds to this certificate killing constraint. Okay. So that's everything. That's everything. So let me just sort of conclude with some open problems. So one bummer about this is that it only works for in the worst case setting. And like so average case monotone circuit lower bounds are actually like extremely interesting, and in particular over like the uniform distribution. Because everyone in this room certainly knows that if I get monotone circuit lower bounds at the slice, then this is just proving non-monotone circuit lower bounds, right? So it's obviously of interest to try and push the min terms and max term sizes as close to the slice as possible. And average case bounds over the uniform distribution are just exactly this, right? Like they're sort of an average case version of this. So it'd be nice to sort of try and take these lifting theorems that we have, these techniques, and try and convert them into reasonable average case lower bounds over good distributions, not over weird min term max term distributions that you get. So a second thing is that I'd like to actually separate the rank measure and the algebraic tiling number. So there's this classic result by Robere, which says, in the non-monotone case, this can't give you any lower bounds. This rank measure is always at most order n. So in fact, you can show that in the non-monotone case, the rank measure is always at most the decision tree complexity, which is funny, because in the non-monotone world, it's decision tree complexity, and in the non-monotone world, it gets you like tight lower bounds, right? So it's even though we have like a nice characterization right here, it'd be nice to find like some reasonable separation. It's not going to work for these lifted functions, obviously, because for lifted functions we know they're the same. But you'd have to actually come up with like a really brand new technique outside of lifting theorems in order to prove this kind of thing. And finally, the question that I also think is very interesting is to try and operationalize the rank measure. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if you go back and you look at this algebraic tiling thing, so like let's suppose that we were in a world where we discovered algebraic tilings first, right? Would we have discovered span programs? Like I don't know. Like you know, like the reduction from span programs to algebraic tilings is beautiful, but it's in depth. Like it's not natural to see how to go from algebra. Like it's not just from the definition of an algebraic tiling. It's not natural to go from one to the other. So perhaps all of these communication complexity measures, which don't currently correspond to circuit models, actually do correspond to circuit models in some sense. So is there some way to sort of systematize this and come up with a generic way of converting back and forth? And so let me plug Mika's talk one more time, because in some settings we're actually able to do this sort of thing. And yeah, that's it. Thanks.
Any questions for Robert? Okay, let's thank him again and resume at 11:30.